All counts towards the hour. Should be even longer, ideally. Well, Clapham Grand. Woohoo! Now, you see, this is proper faded glory, isn't it? It's not overly showbiz, that's what I'm trying to say. I looked at myself in a mirror earlier. And I'm not overly showbiz, am I? His outfit, then the shoes here, the brown shoes, they go with nothing. Out to Clark's. It's custom-made orthopedic inner soles. It's not the height of showbiz, is it? And then looking at you, well, with the greatest respect, it's fair to say no one's made an effort. And there isn't a single top hat to be seen anywhere. Now, I want to instill a certain degree of showbiz sparkle into proceedings. And I can do that with my little claim to fame. Now, listen to this. Not that you've got a choice. I have met Tom Jones. Not unusual. Hey, thank you very much. Now, I met him in Stoke-on-Trent, which makes it slightly more unusual, doesn't it? And I met him at Britannia Stadium, Stoke City's football ground, and it was organised by BBC Five Live. They called it Big Day Out. So they booked several bands, and then they booked Tom Jones, they booked me to do a little bit of comedy, and then prior to the gig, all the performers, we were all backstage. Now, over there he was, Tom Jones. Showbiz legend. Now, I'm not going to miss out on this once in a lifetime opportunity, so I walked over and made a proper nuisance of myself. So, hello, we have never met. My name is Henning. I'm a great fan of yours. So, what are you up to at the moment? And then Tom Jones looked at me and said, well, it's that time of year again. I'm doing my tax return. Well, I'm doing my numbers at the moment, so how are you going about doing your tax return? Because he clearly wanted to talk about it, yes, indeed. Because then Tom Jones said, well, over the course of the year, I chuck all my receipts and invoices in shoe boxes, and then once a year I sit down and work it all out. Now, I have to be honest with you, I would have expected Tom Jones to have a slightly more sophisticated accounting system. I do understand sometimes success can come so quickly you haven't got time to set up the infrastructure, but with Tom Jones then isn't really a plausible explanation, is it? Been going for about 100 years, but anyway, we got on like a house on fire, we really did. He showed genuine interest in my profession, so he asked me if I've ever used one of them flesh-colored microphones that go down the side of your face. Nah, never used one of them. They look a bit naff to me. It's the sort of microphone I would only be using if I was selling knockoff perfume or DVDs down Romford Market. And he laughed like a drain. You have to trust me on that one, eh? He laughed like a drain. I thought, it's unbelievable. Someone that high profile, being so down to earth, amazing. About half hour in, I realised he was an impersonator. And the sentence that gave it away was, I told you, it was a daytime event, and I got on so well with him, I just thought, I'll tell you what, a chance me luck. So I asked Tom Jones if he was up for a few pints after. And then Tom Jones said, yeah, would love to, but I have to drive over to Burnley. I'm singing there in a working man's club tonight. Well, clearly not a real Tom Jones. But I'll tell you what, as it stands, I don't even want to meet a real Tom Jones. Because for all I know, the real Tom Jones might be a proper knob end. There was that one there. That was one spiffing fella. That's certainly my Tom Jones. I don't need any more Tom Joneses in my life. Being a stand-up comedian, don't need any Tom Joneses in my life. Because traditionally, stand-up comedians, they're very, very envious of musicians. Because they've got the easy career. No, honestly, they really do. I really wish I was a musician. What a bloody easy career. All it takes, 3-4 hits, and you've got a career forever. You don't even need 3-4 hits. One is enough. Say someone like the Crazy Frog. He'll never go hungry. Partly because he isn't real, I grant you that. Yeah, but at the same time, there'll always be enough nightclubs that crave a little bit of ring, ding, 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 ring, ding, 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 ding. And yeah, you can understand his appeal, but it's still unfair. Because stand-up comedy, completely different game. We're expected to come up with a new show every year. If you ask me, needlessly. Well, how many people live in the UK? 64 million. My last touring show, Henning Knows Bestest, was seen by 27,000 people. Now, that is very, very respectable, and I'm very, very fortunate. Still, if I round it to the nearest million... was seen by no one, but convention is all the jokes have to go in the bin. In the bin, in the bin, in the bin. Yeah? The jokes from last year's show, they still work. There's fuck all wrong with them. If them jokes were horses, you wouldn't put them down. In the bin, in the bin. Perfectly good jokes, in the bin. And it's that sort of mad consumerism that ultimately killed this planet. And if I then compare the treatment of my jokes, if I compare that to the public outcry over the badger cull, well, they've all got tuberculosis, but they're allowed to live on. My joke's perfectly clean bill of health, but in the bin, in the bin. And the badgers, they're laughing. And coughing. All the way to their apartments. And that is actually one of my guilty pleasures. I'm not sure that's the right word, but I'm absolutely fascinated by the disparity of house prices in the UK. That is a never-ending source of bewilderment and amusement to me. So ever I go, I always try to have a look into the window of the nearest estate agent to get an idea of what the area is like. So, usually when you travel the country, there is choice. Yeah, you can spend a lot on property, but you don't necessarily have to. There's always some shithole nearby. Yeah? So there is that degree of choice. But in central London, there is no choice anymore, is there? I mean, you look into the window of any London estate agent and you'll be greeted by something along the lines of 3-bedroom Victorian house by Central European standards, derelict. With an illusion of a garden in one of London's least desirable areas. That'll cost you the annual GDP of Luxembourg. Yeah, it's mind-boggling, isn't it? Absolutely mind-boggling, especially how they try to justify them outlandish prices. They go, this property boasts a new shower curtain. Oh, fantastic. It's the first £10 explained, but how about the rest? where I live, there is next door to my local bus stop, there is an estate agent. And they put one in the window the other day that completely bowled me over. It said, wood, that was one of the selling points, it said, wood laminate flooring throughout. Well, that should bring the price down, shouldn't it? Because you have to rip that shit out first thing anyway. Yeah, everyone not laughing about men of wood laminate flooring, suggesting a lower middle class. Well, there's nothing wrong with wood laminate flooring. It's quite classy, actually. Well, either way, soon there will only be two groups of people that can still afford to live in inner London, and that's millionaires and people on housing benefit. Everybody else realistically outpriced, isn't it? And why is there such a house price bubble in London and the South East? What's the reason behind it? Is it, I don't know, is it to do that there isn't enough jobs outside the South East? So should the UK become more federal and spread it all a bit more evenly across the island? Is that maybe the way forward, or has it mainly got to do with legislation? Like are tenants' rights not strong enough? Like in Germany, if you're a decent tenant, by which I mean you pay your rent on time and you're not a neighbourhood nuisance, it will take the landlord years rather than weeks or months to get you out of property. Is it maybe that, or is it not that complicated? Is it what everyone down the pub reckons to be the main problem? And the estate agents are all twats. And I think it's all partly to blame, but the core problem is even more basic than that. And it's the existence, it is the concept of mortgages. Yeah, I didn't expect much on that, luckily. By the way, you might have noticed this part of the show isn't really a show. It's more a lecture. strap in. And what we'll need is this, is Henning's book of common sense. And let's quickly look up the definition of a mortgage. A mortgage allows people that can't afford a property to drive up prices to a level where people that otherwise could afford a property can't either. So what's the simple answer? Make them illegal. I rent, there is no shame in renting, or at least there shouldn't be any shame in renting. Call me old-fashioned. If you can't afford something, and seeing you have to borrow lots of money to pay for it, well, you clearly can't afford it, then you can't have it. Thank you very much for that applause. But for one thing, I mean, let me run that by everyone that still didn't get it, because I'm fully aware that is the most confusing thing anyone has ever suggested in the UK ever. If you can't afford it, you can't have it. Live within your means. A few of you putting their heads together, what the fuck's he talking about now? He's understandable, because I don't love renting. No one loves renting, but it's just the alternative is far too scary. For my job, I have to live in London, and I have got nowhere near enough money to buy anything outright. So, and I just don't want a mortgage round my neck. I don't want to have a massive loan to pay back, because that leads to so many other problems, doesn't it? Well, how many times do you hear people go, oh, I hate a job, but it pays the mortgage? Well, effectively, they're admitting they're enslaved by their property. I mean, that makes no sense in anyone's book, does it? And for me, it's even worse. I'm self-employed. I've got no guaranteed income. And that's been going very well over the last 2 years. Been on the radio a little bit on telly, can almost pack a place out like this here, so... And that's not me being facetious. I'm very grateful. But I'm fully aware all it takes is one misguided Holocaust denial... on live television, write down that, Paul. Very fickle business, this. And yes, I know there is such a thing as mortgage insurances. I looked into them, but the thing about them is they insure you against accidents, but crucially, not against lack of work. So if you look in your diary and there is no jobs coming up, you have to chuck yourself down the stairs. to create an insurance case. I mean, that makes no sense in anyone's book. And there is one street that sums up the madness of the London house prices better than any other. It's a street in North London, in Muswell Hill, Cranleigh Gardens. And what, or rather who, is Cranley Gardens famous for? Dennis Nielsen, exactly, the serial killer. 23 Cranley Gardens. It doesn't have a blue plaque. But still, everybody knows that is where Nielsen done most his work. And the hilarious thing, there is, even today, there is still people living in that house. Now, I don't overly believe in feng shui. But there is something very, very creepy about the idea of living in the house of a former serial killer. Like, Fred West's house in Gloucester, knocked down. Ian Huntley's house in Soham, knocked down. Myra Hindley's flat in Manchester, knocked down. Dennis Nielsen's house still standing. Of course, you simply can't afford to knock down a London property. That's the long and short of it. And the reality is even more grim than that. Because do you know, once Dennis Nielsen, once he was found out, the police come round looking for missing body parts and they dug up the ground. And then the landlord spotted his opportunity and put in an extra basement flat. That is the sad reality. Now, you see, I understand. You have to be pragmatic. I get that. You can't just go, it's scary. This house here, Nielsen killed all them people. It's terrible. We have to knock it down. Of course, you couldn't stop there, could you? Because then you would have to go, no, I don't want to live in the house next to the plot of land where Nielsen killed all them people. So you have to knock this house down as well. Can't stop there either. No, I don't want to live in a house next to the plot of land, next to the plot of land. Of course, then ultimately, Dennis Nielsen would have achieved what the German Luftwaffe failed to do. Tower planning of London. Now, it is actually very enjoyable to be talking about the London house price bubble here in London. But I have to say, even if I discuss the topic up north or somewhere, so there is people in the UK, they do understand that the London house price bubble does affect the whole island. And just give you one of many examples. Like the London councils, they can't afford to house immigrants no more. So they send them to the Midlands. So that means there is people, say they've just escaped civil war in Sudan or Somalia. They're mentally completely disturbed. They arrive here in the UK and we send them to Birmingham. Haven't they been through enough? And we're going to say, never sent anywhere nice, are they? Never sent anywhere. Let's quickly have a look in the definitions book. Somewhere nice. Small market town where the W.H. Smith sign is made of wood. And they never sent there, are they? Never sent to Devon, Dorset or Cornwall. Of course not, because all the houses down there have been bought up by Londoners as second and third homes. So the local people down there can't get onto the housing ladder. The housing ladder, a great British institution, a ladder going absolutely fucking nowhere. And don't just take my word for it. Have you recently had a look into any branch of Barclays Bank? They've got a new brochure out advertising their loans and mortgages program. And when I saw it, I simply couldn't believe my eyes. Here, have a look at the front cover. Here it is. It's a letter going absolutely fucking nowhere. They're aware of it. They're aware it's all a scam. I mean, you can hold it any which way you like. It doesn't make any fucking difference. It's like an M.C. Escher painting, eh? They know it's a scam, and all we can do is laugh about it in a hyperinflated, totally unsustainable manner. About the sheer madness of it all. And what's the icing on the cake of the UK property market? Well, it's all them foreign investors. All them Russian oligarchs buying up large parts of the country. I mean, say what you like about that other big property owner, the royal family. But at least they're British criminals. Sort of. Now, all them Russian oligarchs, they've all been in court in the UK. None of them has ever been found guilty of anything. And you always wonder, how can that be so difficult? Should be so straightforward, shouldn't it? Are you Russian? Yeski. Are you a billionaire? Yeski. Guilty! How the fuck is he not? I know that might sound borderline xenophobe, eh? But it's not as if oligarchs ever invented anything. All they've ever done is stolen previously state-owned commodities. Of course they're all criminals of the highest order. But if the British criminal justice system can't even find Rebecca Brooks guilty... what hope is there of ever seeing someone rich being found guilty ever again? The day they told us they let her off, that day I was so angry, I would have happily joined Islamic State. There's something intrinsically wrong with our Western values, but then I'm a fairly optimistic person. So with her, I always thought, ah, well, hopefully one day soon she gets run over by a giant steamroller. That great leveller. Thank you very much. Now, at the moment, we don't quite know how it's all going to continue, is there, with the Russian crooks, because the European Union sanction against the Russian elite, that means it will be harder for them to bring their dodgy money into the UK. And the British government obviously fully aware of that, and that's why they've started to widen the scope, and now they're wooing criminals from other parts of the globe. Now, our beloved mayor, Boris Johnson, he recently went to China to meet up with Wan Yingliang, the richest man in China. Now, does Boris have any idea how corrupt someone has to be to become the richest man in China? China and the United Nations World Corruption Index, they're very much near the top. And they would be up even higher if they hadn't bribed a bloke that compiled that list. And then you wonder, what is the appeal? Why do they all buy up UK and particularly London property? What is the appeal? Well, I reckon they must have been told what we're all constantly being told, that it's a safe investment. Because that's what we're being told 24/7, isn't it? Invest in property, safe investment. Don't you worry, your little pretty heads. Prices will always go up. They'll always go up. Don't you worry, they'll always go up. Now, I don't know why they would. I don't think that back in 1665... when London was infested by the Black Death, most people were dead, most houses stood empty, well, I haven't got any figures to hand. A Zoopla doesn't go back quite far enough. I don't think that was very good news for property values, but luckily back then, only 1 year later, there was a massive stock adjustment. Great Fire of London, started by a rogue estate agent. Now, that's the thing, isn't it? It doesn't even take the Black Death to wipe out the value of a property. All it takes is a little bit of unfortunate weather. His house is falling into the sea along the coastline every year, then Gloucestershire and Cumbria flooded once a year. My neck of the woods, we've recently had a tornado, and a sort of tornado that in other parts of the world would be described as a strong wind. But the result was devastating nonetheless. They'd bring you two pictures. Here, have a butcher's. Here we go. And that's quite good going, isn't it, for a bit of a breeze. The key person here is that fella in the right bottom-hand corner in a yellow high-vis jacket. He's on the phone going, ooh, that'll cost ya. Yeah, but then UK property developers, they're never down for long. Next picture taken only 10 minutes later. Here he is again. At a viewing. with prospective buyers. Easy access, he's going. Easy access, open plan. Alfresco bathroom. Once in a lifetime opportunity. I even throw in a free shower curtain. Now, out of curiosity, who other than myself is a rent payer here this evening? Yeah, well, as rent payers, we're constantly being told that paying rent is money down the drain, isn't it? Well, it's taken out a massive loan to own debt. It's apparently a perfectly sensible decision, eh? As we're told by everyone with a mortgage. Come on, Eddie, get a mortgage. Make me feel better about myself by repeating my massive mistake. Come on, Eddie, get a mortgage. You've got no idea how exciting life gets with the constant threat of repossession. No, I don't. I'd rather continue that way. I rather continue to see my savings eaten up by below inflation interest payments so some irresponsible cunts can keep living beyond their means. You know exactly who you are. Everyone not laughing. Now, let's see. When I slag off the concept of mortgages, I should make one thing very clear. I'm not a Muslim. I'm not. I agree with most aspects of Sharia law. But the one thing I'm not in favor of is that within the Islamic belief system, charging interest is seen as a sin. Now, I don't think it is, unless you do it like Vonga. I mean, that's obviously criminal, isn't it? Charging 5,000% a year in interest. Now, I'm convinced most people that take out a loan with Vonga, they've got absolutely no idea what they let themselves in for. Let's just create a scenario, all non-judgmental. Say there is some bloke up north. And say, all non-judgmental, and then say he wants to treat his wife to a weekend in Blackpool. Yeah, with all the trimmings. A stationary caravan, pleasure beach, arcades, fish and chips, donkey ride. It's on a whole dream package. And then say to make that trip of a lifetime come true, he might have to borrow 200 quid of Vonga. Now, if he pays them back on the day they return to Sunderland, those £200 probably turn into £210, say. But if he doesn't get round to paying them back, then that loan starts accumulating interest at breakneck speed. Because within 12 months, those £200 will have turned into £10,000 sterling for a weekend in Blackpool. Now that is criminal, isn't it? And for the life of me, can I not understand how the Vonga business model can be legal? Also, for the life of me, can I not understand how any of their contracts can possibly stand up in court? Because to my understanding, if you can prove that at the time of entering a financial agreement, you weren't all there, that agreement becomes null and void. And that should be so straightforward to prove, shouldn't it? Did you take out a loan with Vonga? Yes. Acquitted. And because you clearly don't know what you're doing. Now, you don't have to pay him back, but you're not allowed to vote ever again. Fair enough, isn't it? Now, see, I'm fully aware when I stand on stage and slag off the concept of being in debt, I fully understand I can easily come across as very smug. I'm aware of that risk. But it's just, I was brought up so very, very, very differently. Now, I remember when I was little and I would go to the shops with my mutter, my mother, and I would go like any kid. I would go, ich will dies, ich will das, ich will jenes. So I want this, I want that, I want the other. And my mother's reply would always be the same. Without fail, she would say, mach mal die Augen zu, dann siehst du, was du haben kannst. Shut your eyes and you can see what you can have. Yeah, tough love. You try telling that your kids, they report you to social services. Yeah, but if they're then taken off you, that obviously saves you quite a bit in the long run, so... Certainly worth considering. So, and after that upbringing, I studied economics. And there is only one rule to economics. You have to earn more than you spend. Now, I knew that before I studied it. but it was still good to have it academically confirmed. The funny thing is, if you study economics in England, at the end of your course, you're 30 grand down. Now, in my book, that's a fail right there. Because what sort of people end up with an economics degree here in England? That's people that are either used to and see no shame to being in debt, or they're from such a rich background that money doesn't matter. Neither of which is fit to become Chancellor of the Exchequer. Now, is that mindset or skill set, whatever you want to call it, yeah? The only thing you can run is a football club. Because that is all about making massive losses, isn't it? Because the supporters, they hate nothing more than a positive balance sheet. And there hasn't been a single supporter in the history of the game that's ever been singing, solvent till I die. We're solvent till I die. I know I am, I'm sure I am. We're solvent till I die. They hate it. You know, my first job here in the UK was working in the marketing department of Wycombe Wanderers Football Club. Yeah, come on the chair, boys. And then, during my time with the club, the biggest game they had by far was the League Cup semi-final against Chelsea. And then, yeah, well, and then for the game, the club put up the ticket prices, as you would, but led to a certain degree of disgruntlement amongst supporters. Until finally the chairman, Ivor Beeks, had enough and decided to calm everyone down with the following hilarious statement. He said, "Let me make this very clear. None of the additionally generated money will be used to pay off any debt." Is that debt? I'm not saying a German club wouldn't have frittered the money away, but they wouldn't have made it a mission statement to appease supporters. Oh, is there any Spurs supporters in here this evening? Yeah, of course, blimey, more than usual. So, no, I mean, you weren't best pleased with your chairman, Daniel Levy, were you, for when he sold Gareth Bale to Real Madrid for 86 million quid, that he didn't spend a whole lot on new players the very next morning? Well, you can count yourselves lucky I'm not your chairman, because the very moment Real Madrid would have given me 86 million quid for Gareth Bale, that very moment, I would have made the rest of the squad available for sale too. And then this is my lucky day, I would have sold a fucking lot. And I would have closed the club down. And then redeveloped the ground. You're not into housing, no, into giant Wetherspoons. Yeah. Kosher Wetherspoons. Oh. Keep the same clientele, and then on weekends I would be showing the Arsenal. You know, because traditionally the Spurs supporters are more interested in how Arsenal are doing anyway than their own tier. Certainly from October onwards. Now that we are talking about football, we might as well quickly, mightn't we? I'm not sure if you followed it, but there was a tournament last summer. Might be able to jog your memory. Let me have a look. Yeah, back home, everyone's got one. Now, come on, have a look. Have a look. Have a look. This is the closest. Now, since that final, I've been congratulated so many times, I started to believe I actually did play. Well done, Henning. Yeah, thank you very much. Couldn't have done no more. I dragged myself to within an inch of my life. Really all you could expect from me on a day like that. But Germany winning the World Cup was great, wasn't it? Yeah, because there are upsides to Germany having won the World Cup in South America, there are upsides that will be felt all throughout Europe. Because for starters, none of us will ever have to listen to another one of those stupid documentaries about South American footballing excellence. Now, you know the ones that I'm talking about. Yeah, they're always centered around poverty. It's always like, him and his 16 brothers, they had one shoe between them. And that's why he's so good at football. Is that a legitimate conclusion to arrive at? I mean, you tell me, do you reckon in the build-up to the next World Cup, do you reckon the documentary makers, they will come over to Germany and film something along the lines of this well-maintained municipal facility? That's where the young Bastian Schweinsteiger, born into a perfectly supportive middle-class family, and that's their flat, their rented flat, double glazing, wow! Now, I feel a little bit cheeky talking about the World Cup because I know it's last year's news, but then I constantly get reminded of a game half a century ago. So, by comparison, that happened earlier this evening, so... Yeah, but unlike 1966, 1966 will forever be remembered for the final, won't it? Yeah, well, yeah, thank you. And, but this game, I mean, 2014, I reckon, will be remembered for the semi-final, mostly for Germany-Brazil, when bloody Özil missed the opportunity to make it 8. I was gutted. So, anyway, in a build-up to that game, actually, the biggest worry to me was that I was really concerned that the referee might have been told to ensure social stability in Brazil, best guaranteed by a home win. And I know it's quite unlikely that there's any match fixing going on that had anything to do with FIFA, seeing how above board all their other business dealings are. But anyway, so the German media, in the end, it was agreed there will be no fixing going on because it's too big an event. It's the World Cup semi-final. The whole world is watching. It's right there in the international media glare. It is simply too high profile for there anything dodgy to happen. If you think about it, it doesn't make much sense, does it? Because surely it got to be easier to fix a World Cup semi-final. It must be easier than trying to fix some lower league game. Just pick a random lower league game. Say Scottish lower league. Say Stenhouse Muir versus Queen of the South. That game's only got 2 bets on it. There is wee Jimmy, who puts 50 pence on his cousin as first goal scorer. Then Haggard Hamish sticks a quid on Stenhouse Muir at half-time, full-time. Oh, hang on, a third bet just coming. Mr. Chong from China sticks £1 million on 6 corners in the first 15 minutes. It's a little bit obvious, isn't it? It's a little bit obvious. Also, if you want to match fix Stenhouse Muir, Queen of the South, you have got the additional problem. The players, they might have the criminal mindset, but have they got the footballing ability to make the desired result come in? You can almost picture it, yeah? All 22 players are in on it, and then after 10 minutes, they've got their desired 6 corners. And then we're in for the nerviest 5 minutes in the history of the game. There's very clear understanding. There will be no tackling, there will be no challenging, there will be nothing. We'll just kick the ball up the pitch to you lot, and then you give it back to us. Then we kick it your way again. Well, some clumsy cunt is going to slice the ball down. Over the line it goes. Clumsy cunt, a little bit of an unnecessary swear word, but... Well, actually, quite accurate. That's exactly what the other 21 players would be shouting. I always enjoyed when athletes try to rig an event and they get found out. And because I love the excuses so much. Like my favourite from years ago, I'm sure some of you remember. You remember John Higgins? He was at the time the world number one snooker player. And he was recorded negotiating match fixing in snooker. He was recorded during his week off in a hotel room in the Ukraine, that well-known holiday destination. Then once the footage came to light, his excuse was simply fantastic, because he was there with his manager, and Higgins' excuse was, he said, well, I had no idea why we went to the Ukraine. Now, that is a fantastic statement, isn't it? He's a 40-year-old man that claims he had no idea why he went to the Ukraine. Now, if my manager is ever going to ring me and say, Henning, tomorrow morning, come to the airport, we're flying to the Ukraine. Now, call me overly inquisitive. But my very, very first question will be, why? What are we going there for? Not John Higgins, straight on the fucking plane. No questions asked. Now, obviously, I don't expect a phone call anytime soon because, well, stand-up comedy doesn't really lend itself to spread betting. Also, I haven't got any time to go to the Ukraine. I'm far too busy going up and down Blighty performing to you good people. And usually I go by public transport. Prefer that much over going by car. Because public transport, you simply experience more. Even though every now and then it's the sort of experience where you go, oh, I wish I hadn't experienced this. And like earlier in the run, I took a train from Hull to London. And the first stop is Howden. And for whatever reason, there was loads of Japanese people on the platform. Lots of Japanese men. And I had no idea what they'd been doing there. Anyway, they all got on the train. And the carriage was already quite full there to spread out a bit. So one of the Japanese fellas ended up sitting next to me. So after a while, I had to get up and go to the toilet. And then by the time I come back, he had put his bag on my seat. Fair enough, he must have thought I was getting off. But seeing I hadn't got off, I expected him to immediately remove the bag. But didn't do anything. So looked at him, thought, well, it should be fairly self-explanatory what I want to happen. But no reaction at all. Maybe something cultural. Because Japanese people, they're traditionally very difficult to face read, aren't they? Because they're the most gormless looking creatures on the planet. Now, I know the more acceptable term is inscrutable. And I absolutely hate that word because that's essentially saying there is something happening up there. I'm just too stupid to decipher it. Now, that might well be the case, but I want to retain my right to think that probably once in a while there is fuck all happening up there. So anyway, finally the penny dropped. He removed his bag and I sat back down in my seat. And I was furious on the inside. I thought, what a wally. How can that have taken the best part of a minute to work out? What a tool. It's no point getting angry with him. There is about as sensible as getting angry with a puppy for not doing the washing up. No. So what I didn't know, at that point, I was only a few minutes away from the by far most embarrassing moment of my life. Because do you know who walked down the aisle shortly afterwards? The Japanese man I initially sat next to. Oh, my God. They really all look the same to me. I am the scum of the earth. I'm not paying any attention to my fellow human beings. I am dreadful. I was at my lowest ebb. And you know who came to my rescue? My new seat neighbor. Because I sat there in a seat that hadn't been mine, utterly embarrassed, not knowing what to do with myself. I took out my football magazine when Saturday comes and I flicked through it. And then when I got to the letters page, the Japanese fella next to me started to get really, really excited. So he pointed at the picture, pointed at me, pointed at the picture, pointed at me. I've got a picture enlarged for you. Da-da! Gordon Hill, the old United midfielder. Now, he thought that was me. In other words, we all looked the fucking same to them. And as long as we understand we're all ignorant the world over, we can all be friends. Friends that can't recognise each other, but friends nonetheless. Now, when he came out with that one, I was so relieved. I wanted to kiss the bloke. No, see, because if he hadn't messed up too, I would have felt the need to improve myself. And that's a situation you don't want to find yourself in. No, because self-improvement, just like home improvement, is never happy stories, isn't it? Right? I mean, I'm reasonably happy with myself, or at least not unhappy to the degree that I want to change anything too drastically. You know, I'm now in my 40s, and the only thing I want to learn between now and my death is how to ride a mobility scooter. Yeah, it might strike you as slightly unambitious, but again, I can track that back to my upbringing because the by far most sensible thing I learned at school came thanks to our maths teacher, Herr Bratfisch, Mr. Fried Fish. And He had qualifications well beyond and above what he needed to be a school teacher. So one day, one of my fellow pupils asked him why he wasn't working in the private sector where he could earn loads more money. And then Bradfish, he thought for a split second, and then, ach, wenn man jeden Tag seine Grenzen erreicht, ist man im falschen Beruf. If you have to push yourself to your absolute maximum, to your absolute limit every day, you're in the wrong job. Now, that is a fantastic thing to hear from a teacher, isn't it? A teacher, they have a realistic idea of your own limitations, yeah? Live within your own intellectual means. Yeah? And because no job is worth getting a heart attack for. That's bottom line, isn't it? No job justifies getting an eating disorder. Like when people always say, you have to overcome your fears. Why? Can anyone give me a decent explanation why? If your fears interfere with the necessities of everyday life, then yes, say you're afraid of breathing. And you must address that as a matter of utmost urgency, but most of them other fears, they're there for good reason, aren't they? Not to jump out your window, not to piss yourself in public, not to nail your cock to a plank of wood. Yeah, overcoming those fears, it might seem a really good idea at the time, but you will be regretting it. Certainly once it's all over social media. And you're an incredibly young and trendy crowd, I have to say. So you're all, I guess, you're very familiar with all that sort of thing. And social media, they get a lot of criticism. I have to be honest with you. I'm a technical Luddite, but even I can tell you they're a good thing, social media. Because you can use them in a very positive way. Like social media, they tell you a lot about yourself. You can find out a lot about yourself on social media. Like in my case, if it wasn't for Twitter, I wouldn't know that my eyes are too far apart. I had no idea. Absolutely no idea. Not even an inkling. Turns out my eyes are too far apart. Now, I always thought eyes are too far apart when they're on the side of your head and you can't form a three-dimensional picture. Oh, well, they're too far apart. They don't work, but no. Turns out my eyes are too far apart. You couldn't make it up. Now, honestly, with all the physical imperfections I've got, I really didn't think anyone would go for me eyes. Thought the most obvious one would be my burned arm. They were, oh, look at him, poor man Simon Weston. Yeah, but no one's ever giving me shit about me. I'm not sure up there if you can properly appreciate the degree of disfigurement. Yeah, but the front row will confirm it looks properly fucked. Yes, I'm nodding there, thank you very much, madam. Very good for my self-esteem. Now, might as well quickly tell you how I got this. I got this when I was 1 year old, not as a present. Nor a punishment, I should point out. So, now, I was just at the age where I learned how to move about a little bit. And then I was in one of them, I don't know the exact term, but like a Zimmer frame for children. And I made my way to the kitchen and then I pulled a pot of hot water off the stove and... Now, it's no good going, it's a bit late, honestly. No, I've had this all my life. I don't know any different. And I could fully move it. It's never been a hindrance. Same time, never been a great advantage. With one notable exception. And that was the only time that I ever went to a Formula One race. Now, there is no Niki Lauda joke coming out now. Only terrible, that gentleman there. Now, see, I had never been to Formula One and I went to Silverstone. And I didn't know how it goes, so I just walked up to the box office and they've got different category tickets. You can either buy a ticket in a stand, but they were really dear. I thought, no, I'm not paying that much for a car race, I'm simply not interested enough. So I bought one of the cheapest tickets, a ground pass. And the ground pass allows you to walk around the circuit. And then at the point of your choosing, you're allowed to press your face against the fence. And then you can see 20 yards that way and 20 yards that way. Now, I can see ever so slightly further. But it's a negligible advantage. So, anyway. So, I... having said, I'd never been to the Formula One. I had no idea in reality how small those cars are. They're not much bigger than a shopping trolley. And they were minuscule. I also had no idea how fast they actually are. So when they were going by, I genuinely couldn't even make out their colour. It was just a ball of incredible noise flying past. I thought, this is the worst sporting event I've ever been to. This is rubbish. What a waste of a Sunday. I wish I'd stayed at home and listened to the Archers. And it's coming to a lot when I prefer that. So, what a rubbish day. But I thought, now I'm there, and so I might as well make the most of it and get a little bit of exercise out of it. So I carried on walking around the circle. And then I saw a stand exclusively for disabled people. So I looked at my arm, listened to my conscience, telling me, sod it, it's now or never, make it come. So I walked up to the steward, pointed at my arm and said, this'll do, won't it? And he let me in. I mean, obviously, he saved himself a very embarrassing conversation. Nah, sorry, mate, you're not quite disabled enough. Ah! I had a plan B. Luckily, didn't need it. So, anyway, there I was in the disabled stand. And it was a complete game changer. There was even a seat still available. It was fantastic. Fairly high up in the stand and had a really good angle onto the racetrack. So I could see proper racing maneuvers, proper overtaking and everything. I could really understand why Formula One is such a popular spectator sport. And it was made even better by what a fantastic group of people I was watching the race with. Because usually I go to the football, and that can be so tribal that it becomes simply unenjoyable. But they had a Formula One where I said, we all had such a healthy outlook on life. We all knew what matters in life and what doesn't matter. So we didn't rate one team over another or one driver over another. So whoever was going by, we were all just going, ha-ha, car! It was the most innocent fun I ever had. It was fantastic. But there was still time for one more twist. And that was when the race came to its climax. The constant noise and excitement got a little bit too much for my fellow spastic in the seat in front of me, and he got an epileptic fit. The paramedics had to arrive, and again I couldn't see. It's fascinating, isn't it? I've just told you a true anecdote in which I admitted to, if not inventing, then at least exaggerating my degree of disability for my own advantage. And for good measure, I chucked in the most unacceptable word in the English dictionary, but no one really holds it against me. Because of my job, because I'm a stand-up comedian. Now imagine, if I told you exactly the same anecdote in with the same word, and I wouldn't be a stand-up comedian, but your local MP. I would be in hotter water than I've ever been before, wouldn't I? I said earlier on, I said stand-up comedian, harder job than musician. I firmly believe that to be the case, but nowhere near as difficult as politician. Because that is the ultimate damned if you do, damned if you don't job, isn't it? They get criticised whatever it is. The criticism will either be, there's hardly any left of me wages. It all goes out in tax to them fuckers on benefits. They don't even want to work. I would make them all sweep the streets. Bloody benefits culture. Now, the moment that person loses their job, they ever so slightly change their tune, don't they? I can't believe this is all the benefits I get after 30 years of working. It's an absolute disgrace. And even on a personal level, even someone as dislikable as George Osborne. No, and he comes across a fairly dislikable individual, doesn't he? But even he is given a totally unfair deal. People are going, he's a robot, he's a people destroyer, he has got no emotion. Then, at the Thatcher funeral, his eyes went ever so slightly moist, and the whole country united and was up in arms. Look at that emotional queer, he's not fit to run the country. He's always in London, why is he always in London? Well, last week he was in Wolverhampton. What the fuck's he doing in Wolverhampton? Why wasn't he in London? He must be waking up most mornings hoping he had a passing resemblance to Tom Jones. What a dreadful job. I mean, the worst aspect must be, I guess, well, obviously without any first-hand experience, but the worst aspect must be that they know for a fact the electorate despises them. But by right, everyone is entitled to come up to them and expect them to do something about their individual problems. Like during the last parliament, the story that really took the biscuit for me, you might have followed that. There was a British lady, she went to South Korea to have her pet dog cloned. Not eaten, cloned. So once that thing was cloned, it had to remain in quarantine for 6 months. Now, what did she do? She sent a letter to the Prime Minister telling him to do something about it, because her dog, obviously a matter of national importance. Now, the moment that letter comes through the door of 10 Downing Street, there is only one sensible course of action, isn't there? In the bin, in the bin. But it's not a course of action open to the Prime Minister, because he knows full well she would be straight off to the tabloids. You can already picture the headlines, can't you? PM's vile dog snub. Millions of owners are asking, is he a cat man? You know, some bollocks like that, accompanied by a picture of a puppy doing the washing up or something. So that means the Prime Minister has to reply to that letter. Obviously not him personally, but one of his taxpayer-funded aides. And that means you paid for that letter, you paid, 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 I paid, you paid, you paid, you paid, you paid, you get the picture, you paid, you paid, people at home, you paid, you paid. And we all paid for that letter, but the real travesty is in all probability that letter didn't tell her to fuck off. My name is David Cameron, I'm the Prime Minister of this country. Fuck off, are you off your trolley? I've got enough problems as it is. Worst of all, I have to sustain a massive housing bubble, so the last thing I need is you and your stupid dog bringing the Black Death once again, thank you very much. And now we're coming towards the false ending of this show, where you will be demanding an encore. But I'm not sure, I mean, you're a lovely audience, but I'm not sure if I can fully trust you yet. So probably I suggest we rehearse you demanding the encore. Yeah, and I would like you to do it the German way. And in Germany, we shout, Zugabe! 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 Very good. Very good, thank you very much. Try to remember that. You know, I need to deliver something that justifies such a spontaneous outbreak of jolliness and goodwill. And I think I've just got the jokes for it. Two fat blokes go to the pub, says the first one, you around, says the other one, so are you, you fat bastard. One more. Why did my grandfather cross the road? To occupy France. Yeah. See you very much. See you next time. Bye. Did you see? Have you seen the poster? No. And then you're. Anyway, what's he doing with Jimmy Cricket's head? No, he's not. It's the outfit from on the poster. You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know about you, but whenever I go and see a show, there's a very distinct outfit being worn on the poster. And if then that outfit doesn't make an appearance at any point in the show, I always feel a little bit shortchanged. And I at least have the good grace to wear it during the encore. So, yeah, thank you very much. Obviously, the impact is ever so slightly diminished if you haven't seen the poster. I give you that. But now, what? I'm still with this show. I'm still, even though I'm filming it now, but I'm still haven't fully worked out the audience expectations. I've performed the show now a fair few times, but I still don't quite know what the audience want. Like this evening. How much actual DIY did you expect to see here on stage? And hopefully very, very little, because see, I thought of this show title a long time ago, last March, so well over a year ago. And thought of it, I thought, well, 1-2 DIY, really good. It's a bilingual pun, really strong. So I bought the outfit, then had photos taken, posters designed, sold to show into theatres under that name. And only once all the logistical side was dealt with, did I sit down to actually write the show. And then very quickly did I realise I'd made a massive mistake. Because it transpired, I've got absolutely no DIY-related anecdotes. Because I'm a rent payer. Thank you very much. That's actually the best joke in the whole encore, so should end it here, but nah. There is different theories, isn't it, how to do an encore. Now, one school of thought is you have to build up to a big finale. I it's not really me. I prefer to steadily run it into the ground. Now, because I firmly believe the more shambolic the encore is, the more obvious it has to be how slick the show had been up to that moment. And the concept of an encore is a strange one at best of times, isn't it? Essentially saying, ooh, you done well, now do some more. For free. Now imagine you're having a really good day in the office, boss comes in at 5 o'clock, and then, ooh, you're really on a roll today, why don't you stick around another 2 hours? Unpaid, of course. Well, last time anyone would reach their daily performance targets, but still got a German work ethic, so I'm not too bothered, actually. I must say, I really enjoy doing stand-up because, well, on the tours, you see a lot of Britain. That's brilliant. And then I'm quite lucky, as in I'm never overly affected by nerves. Because I don't overly care how a gig goes. And that sounds slightly wrong. I mean, it's not. I mean, but what I'm trying to say is I'm always more interested in the gliding average of a show. So if over time a show gets better, that's the only thing I'm really interested in. I've got quite a macro approach to stand-up comedy. And some of my colleagues are very micro, which I'm convinced is the first step towards insanity without a shadow of a doubt. Because, they give so much importance to every single performance. Before a show, they're so nervous, they can't eat all day. Then even after the show, they're so high on adrenaline, again, they can't eat. So if they're on the road for 4 or 5 days, they go without food for 4 or 5 days. And then I look at them and think, well, why do they put themselves to that degree of mental torment? Why do they give themselves stomach ulcers? Why do they do it? Why? Why? What do you reckon? Why? 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 What do you reckon? Pay the mortgage! Exactly right! Oh. That was hard work, wasn't it? 1 out of 400. What a waste of an evening. Now, sometimes you picture how a show might end, and really... I mean, you're such a lovely audience. I was convinced when I go at the end, when I go, so why do they do it? I was convinced you would all jump up as one because he pays the mortgage, a financial instrument that shouldn't be legal in the first place. Instead, the government should strengthen tenants' rights, and if you're a decent tenant, pay your rent on time, you're not a neighbourhood nuisance, it will take the landlord years to get you onto property in accordance with the Deutsche Grundgesetz, the German Constitution, where it says in Article 14, it says, Eigentum verpflichtet, property entails obligation. Then I thought you would all come to the stage, carry me out on your shoulders, out there, Clapham High Street, and declare me the new mayor of London. Well, the reality was somewhat different, wasn't it? If it hadn't been for that lovely gentleman over there, I would still be standing here going, yeah, why? Come on, son. Why? Come on. Why? Well, to overcome their fears? No! I mean, maybe, but not the answer I wanted. But... see, well, that's the best thing about doing stand-up in the UK. And no matter how ropey a gig might go, the worst that can happen to a performer is that someone will come up to them after and go, I enjoyed it. 13 years ago, I would have taken that as a face value compliment, but now I understand it's the British way of saying that, or shit. It's the same leak as good effort. That was interesting. You're so brave. Stand-up comedy, that must be the hardest job in the world. Standing on stage making other people laugh. I couldn't do it. Either. And they all said to me time again, usually at me, when I started out, the compere would come on after me and go, give Henning another round of applause. And he's doing it in his second language. And I will always take that as a face value compliment. Someone explained to me, no, he's saying no one could understand a bloody word. Oh. And now my English has improved. Now it's at the level people ask me, Henning, 13 years in Britain. Henning, do you dream in English? Or do you dream in German? What can I say? Do I dream in English? Do I dream in German? All my dreams are silent movies in which everyone gets on with their work. Can you imagine? Thanks so much. You have been an absolute delight. Now it's time, one more time, to theme tune! I'm sorry.